headquarters in downtown Louisville. I, of course, am Brian Zipsy. We're doing another Triple Crown Insider, Belmont Stakes Insider. We are loaded with fun guests tonight. We have the McGee brothers. We got Marty McGee, Eclipse Award-winning turf rider from Daily Racing Form. His brother is young. Is it younger brother?
Younger brother.
Younger brother Paul McGee of many, many great stakes wins. Top trainer here in Kentucky. And of course, as usual, my partner, the Churchill Downs celebrity, Joe Christofek. Joe, what do we want to talk about first with these guys?
There's so much. I mean, we're going to get to the Justin Harbour, who's on the list of probables for the Stephen Foster. We're going to talk about Marty. Talk to Marty about covering the beat here in Kentucky and his job at DRF. And, you know, we want to talk about some of the stuff in the past, too, how you guys got to where you are. But before we can get to any of that, Brian mentioned brothers. You're a writer, you're a trainer, and obviously there's a joint love of horse racing. So if you guys can just kind of tell us the story about how that happened. Marty, how you became a writer, and Paul, how you become a trainer, because it's horse racing, but, you know, you usually have to deal with guys like him that aren't your brother, the media, right? And you have to deal with guys like him, the trainers, to get your work done. So how did that all happen?
Well, our dad, Jimmy McGee, who died in 2008, used to take me and Paul and our sisters, Susan and Amy, as a lot of people know, is married to Ron Ellis, the trainer out in California. They lived out there about 30 years. But my dad used to take us to the tracks, and I remember going to Miles Park with them down in the West End, and I remember going to Ellis Park with him once, and he used to take us to Louisville Downs, and he'd have $30 in his pocket. He didn't have two nickels to rub together, and of course that was for doubles and exactas and stuff, and he would bet to win, and the horse would run second. I said, Dad, they have place betting, and he, you know, because we didn't get a hot dog or a Coke until, it's a true story, until he cashed the ticket. So
no treats until you win.
No treats till you win. So, and it just kind of fed our interest, and I always had kind of an affinity for reading and writing, and I remember when I was 11 or 12, I wanted to be a sports writer. And that quickly evolved into, I wanted to be a racing writer, so I went to University of Kentucky and was the sports editor for the Colonel, the school newspaper. Just kind of custom made my own streamline into becoming a horse racing writer. In 1985, I moved to Maryland. That was my first job with the short-lived Sports Eye, calling charts. Did that for a little while. They folded, and then Chicky Lang, the late Chicky Lang, the son of the late Chick Lang, got me on with the Baltimore Sun in July of 85, and then I worked for the Sun until early 92, and then I went to the Forum, and I counted up the other day. I've covered racing in 17 states now, mostly here in Kentucky, but as you well know, Joe and I met back in 93 in Chicago. I was on the Chicago beat for 2 or 3 years, and then come back for certain summers, and, you know, it's just... My bosses have often asked me, you know, what can we do better, or what are your complaints, and I always say I'm in the top 1% of people who enjoy their job. You know, even though we all get upset about certain politics that go on in our business, but, you know, I tell kids, if you know what you want to do with your life, just set a path for yourself and go do it, and I've been very fortunate in that respect.
Now, Paul, what about the horsemanship part? Because Marty obviously explained that. You're going to the track with your dad. Did you gravitate towards the animal? And after you answer that question, would you ever let Marty rub horses or walk hops for you?
I have walked hops for it, but that was a long time ago.
Very few hops.
Not recently.
I've always been an animal lover, and when I was 15 years old going through St. X, I was cutting grass at the Imperial House Apartments, and a lot of the trainers and jockeys were staying there, and I met Jerry Calvin. And Jerry said, man, you sure are interested in these horses. He says, why don't you come out and walk hops for me one morning? And my first morning on the backside of Churchill Downs, walking hops for Jerry, I knew then, that was me. That was me. I loved it, to have Donnie Brumfield coming through the barn and Jimmy McKnight and Julio Espinosa. And these were the guys that I would get their autographs at the races. And so I was just really starry-eyed being on the backside. And for me to be able to walk those horses, and I would go out after school and cool them out after the races, and, you know, really just absolutely loved it. The backside got me hook, line, and sinker, and I've done it ever since. Galloped horses out there for Carl Bowman when I was going through Bellarmine College, and but shortly after graduating Bellarmine, after a stint as Carl's assistant trainer, I went out on my own and started claiming a couple of horses, and lucky for me, success bred success, and word of mouth and that kind of thing, to where I got more and more horses, and entered Samantha Siegel at one point. Samantha started sending me horses from California, and that was a real godsend for me. My stable really grew when I took on the Siegel horses, and if you enjoy your job, you never work a day in your life, and that's definitely applied to me, because I still enjoy it today, but it's just been a real labor of love, for sure.
Two guys who enjoy their job. Now, I'm just wondering, Paul and Marty, it almost seems like you could do these career paths, these successful career paths, completely separate, but were you talking a lot about what you're going to do, what you're going to do, and it just took off together? You fed off each other a little bit, or...?
I don't know if we did. We kind of did it independently. Now, when I moved to Maryland in 85, I remember the day Paul graduated Bellarmine. He called it college. We all know it as university now, but it was a college back then. The day he graduated in a December semester, I surprised him. I'd driven in from Maryland. We drove back together, and he started living with me back there in Maryland. So he probably came up there during the down times here in Kentucky, you know, the summers and some of the winters. He would come up there and actually live with me probably three or four different times. And so we kind of had that going for us. And I think it's kind of helped both of us in terms of credibility in the business, in that, you know, if people question, well, what the heck do you know? Well, I know I say, well, you know, my brother's a trainer, and I can always ask him. Numerous times I've asked him about the physiology of horses and certain things that would apply to a trainer that, you know, you would really need a lot of experience to know, and I just kind of ask him that applies. And I think I've helped him media-wise in terms of being more comfortable in terms of dealing with the press and actually knowing what we're looking for and things like that. So it's kind of, in that respect, it's kind of fed on each other through the years.
So Baltimore Sun, were you the handicapper, racing writer, covering Preakness? Because now we know in 2016, racing writers and newspapers are becoming extinct, right? So it was a different job back then. What exactly did you do there?
It was so different. You know, I was the handicapper. They would have initially I was the handicapper until Dale Austin, who was my mentor, he just died a couple years ago. He left the Racing Times in 91, and in the meantime, Dale would be gone so much that I would do a lot of the writing that applied to the Maryland circuit. He'd be going to the Derby or the Breeders' Cup or whatever, and sometimes I would do freelancing and joining in those spots, but as a matter of fact, I haven't missed a Derby since 74. Even when I was living in Maryland, I wasn't assigned to the Derby, I would come back. But anyway, you know, it's just, what's the question again?
Well, exactly what they
do. Oh, what were my duties? Yeah.
Books about the locals. We don't ever see that in newspapers anymore.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the coverage back then was so great. Back when I worked in Maryland, we had Andy Beyer and Vinnie Perrone for the Washington Post and Clem Florio. I mean, these guys were all iconic. Mm-hmm. They were just from one newspaper, the Washington Post. You had Jack Mann for the Evening Sun, formerly of the Washington Times. You had Dale Austin, who I mentioned, for the Sun paper, and myself. Ross Petticord was a terrific writer for the Evening Sun. And then, as we all know, over the last quarter century, it's just all kind of gone by the wayside. As a matter of fact, I understand that Jenny Reese, who was there for 34 years, the fellow who has replaced him, Jonathan...
Wintner,
yeah. He's leaving, so...
The current journal,
And
he's
so
too young to leave.
Well, he's taking another job just because the newspaper, it's so hard to work anymore in the newspaper industry. And for whatever reason, horse racing is not as respected or thought of as a mainstream sport the way it used to be. And, you know, So I just have a lot of fond memories of back when the press boxes were busy, when we were together in Chicago, the Sun Times and the Tribune, yeah. and you had all kinds of stuff going on.
Right.
This might be Pandora's box, but Marty, why isn't racing what it used to be?
I think it is what it used to be. It's just taking its, you know, things like this and
sports sections are shrinking in the paper.
Sports sections in general, yeah. And you know, there's a lot of good writing going on out there. It's just in different forums.
Yeah, right on. So Marty's cutting his teeth at the Baltimore Sun. You take out your trainer's license. How old were you? You were young.
I was 25.
Okay, so you had gotten to the point of maturity. But how did it go at the beginning? Like, how did you get the ball rolling and find some success? You mentioned Samantha Siegel. That was
big. Yeah. Well, I made a couple of good claims early on, which really meant a snowball effect. I had actually a two-horse stable the first year that Marty recruited me up there to Laurel for winter racing, and one of those horses was Baltazar B, who went on to win the Clark Handicap. So,
and the second one was Bet the Pot, who won the first ever running of the Aristides, which we're going to run here Saturday at Churchill.
Yeah. So I had just off to a great start and went from a two-horse stable to a six-horse stable to a 10-horse stable. Like Marty was talking about Maryland back then, to me, that was just big time. The winter racing at Laurel back in the late 80s when Frank Francis owned... I mean, it was really rolling up there in Maryland at the time. But it was just really exciting for me to be claiming horses in that time frame and building a stable. And when you win races, it makes it a lot of fun.
We're going to have Brian talk about some of your bigger horses in a second. I just want to dish some stats real quick. Career starters, 5,457, 986 wins. So, Paul, you're only 14 away from 1,000. That's a huge milestone for a trainer, and obviously you've got a lot of good years ahead of you. You're in the top 15 all-time at Churchill, I believe 14th, but obviously you're still active, so you're going to continue to move up that list, which is also quite an accomplishment. 19 graded stakes, and you're synonymous with Bet on Sunshine. We're going to talk about a lot of your other big winners over the years as well. Brian, where do we start?
Well, Bet on Sunshine. Anybody who follows the Breeders' Cup, I think, or Kentucky Racing knows Bet on Sunshine. He was a bit of a legend, and really the first horse I knew trained by Paul McGee. Bet on Sunshine. Three times in the Breeders' Cup, two times very close. I think we should tell the story, Paul, of how you got Bet on Sunshine in your stable. That's an interesting story.
Yeah, Bet on Sunshine was actually a repo. Mr. Holloway, who I trained him for, he got a call from Junior Cerna, who was at a farm in Ocala. And what had happened was Bet on Sunshine sold as a two-year-old in training in Ocala. The people that bought him had him sent to California. Well, they never paid for him. So now OBS, the sales company, repos the horse. He's now 3 years old, and he's back in Ocala, and he's for sale. And they wanted $25,000 for him. So Mr. Holloway said, tell him I'll give him $22,000. So he was sold, and Mr. Holloway sent the horse to me, and the rest is history.
And one other part about that, though, there was another fella, real nice guy named Paul McGee, MAGEE, who was training at the time. He was really good friends with Tony Rheinstetler. And I'm sure you know this part of it. Well, David Holloway, the owner of Bet on Sunshine, had been using Tony Rheinstetler as a trainer, and for whatever reason, maybe Tony didn't have enough stalls. Well, David Holloway said to Tony, Tony, can you recommend a trainer to me? He said, yeah, Paul McGee. He met the other Paul McGee, M-A-G-E-E, and I remember talking to the other Paul McGee about that years later. He's like, yeah, that was supposed to be my horse.
Yeah. Wow, so 22 wins from 47 starts, $1.4 million in earnings later. He retires at age 10. I mean, just a warrior, and he didn't really slow down with age until he retired, and... You know, Brian, we should talk a little bit more about the career.
Kentucky legend. I remember he didn't come out until late in his three-year-old year. Didn't win first out. Oh, no, that's a trend with your horses, I guess.
Yes, it is.
When you said, yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't get him to win first time out.
But I think impressive second time out there. And then he became a stakes horse. I guess that was his four-year-old year. And then his Breeders' Cup career started after several stakes races as a five-year-old.
Yeah, he was a very exciting horse, very very classy horse. That was the thing about Bet on Sunshine, was how very classy he was. In the paddock, on the walkover, just all those big races and everything, he never turned a hair. And just one of those horses that he knew when it was race day, but he was always very well behaved and just always very classy. But the way he'd go out there and run his race every time is just uncanny. You just don't run into that very often. Maybe him not debuting until late in his three-year-old year had a lot to do with his longevity. He won the Aristides at Churchill as a nine-year-old. So that tells you right there how very sound of a horse he was.
When did you know you had something special with Bennett Sunshine?
I would say after his debut.
Before he ever won?
Yeah, because he was always a good workhorse. You know, he had some 59s and some, anytime I breeze him, you know, always a minute flat, very much under wraps, that kind of thing. So, but he won an allowance race on Oaks Day. When he won a 1X, that would have been as a four-year-old. He won very impressively, and so, again, he just went up. After that, it was pretty much stakes races. So,
what was the first conversation that you two had, Marty, if you can remember this, about a Bet on Sunshine, or obviously you guys, I guess, talk about Paul's horses. You see him, you have to handicap the races. Does he say, man, I got a good one here? I mean, how does that?
Well, you kind of learn over the years. I remember one night going to the Spectrum, you know, the old Simon torture place that where I would go bet, and he had four horses in one night at Turfway, and I loved three of them, and I bet my lungs on three of them, and of course they all lost and the other one won. So he's like any other trainer in that he doesn't know who's going to win. You know, he has a pretty good idea, but you know this, Joe, from having gone to the paddock as much as you do. If you ask all 12 trainers if they like their horse, pretty much all of them are going to say, yeah, you know, got a shot, blah, blah, blah. So in my opinion, the handicappers, maybe even the jockey agents, not the jockeys, not the owners, not the trainers, the guys who know how to match them all up together, they probably got the best opinions. But again, you know, it's a tough game, as we all know. So for me, having talked to him, I know when he likes them. Yeah, our brother-in-law, Ron Ellis, he's notorious for not liking a horse and they win. I mean, it's just like, it's like the opposite of what he likes. So it's a lot about handicap.
Yeah.
Well,
you know your horse, but you don't know who you're in against.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, you know, your horse might be working like secretariat, but still, he's running against these other son of a guns who are doing real good, too.
Right.
It's hard to be unbiased when you're looking against horses that you're going against.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of, you know, a lot of, over the years, I've done this 31 years now, I've had to write, you know, or he's been involved in races where I'm writing about them. And I can say without equivocation that I've never shown any kind of bias in any way, shape, or form, and I've never been accused of it either. So a lot of times, though, when he, like, say, for instance, on Oaks' year this year when he won with Majestic Harbor, I take myself off that race. We've got other DRF staffers in town to write about it, so I'm not writing about it. Now, I still have to make the picks, and I did happen to pick that horse, but, I mean, there's been... So I got to go on the winner's circle. That's one of my self-imposed rules, is I can only go in as winner's pictures if I pick the horse on top in our selection box. So you know, otherwise it's kind of...
Powerful angle, people.
What did he pay that day?
He paid $28. But I picked him a lot where he lost. You know, you got to remember that part. People like, oh, you're all dressed up to go in winner's circle. Like, no, I'm not doing that. I'm not dressed up today because of that.
Yeah.
You know, if it happens to happen together, great.
We want to talk more about Majestic Harbor. We're going to go through a little bit more of the historical stuff. Brian, this might be a good time.
Yeah, let's. Why don't we start with Bet on Sunshine? I think there's, you know, it's been close to 20 years now, but Bet on Sunshine is such a popular horse, such a great Kentucky horse. Paul, did he, I don't remember Ben on Sunshine running too many races past sprint distance. Did he ever stretch out?
Actually, there was one time when late in his career, he had to have been either 7 or 8 years old, but I got a wild hair, and he was eligible for a route race at Churchill, going a mile and a 16th, a money allowance race at Churchill, because it was for horses that hadn't wanted a mile or over. So I've got a wild hair. I bounced it off of Mr. Holloway and bounced it off of Calvin Burrell, and they both kind of looked at me like I was crazy, but he won the race. He went wire to wire, and he looked like he was in an absolute gallop all the way around there.
But I remember Neil Howard after that, his buddy and fellow trainer Neil Howard said, "Boy, you've been doing things so wrong with this horse for so many years."
We had Neil Howard.
He's a two-turn specialist.
That's right.
Neil Howard joined us last week. All right, Joe, why don't we break, because we want to look at Bet on Sunshine a little bit. Unfortunately, Paul, it's not from a winning performance, but it was from a great performance. We're going to see Bet on Sunshine just driving up the rail the whole way. We're talking about the 1997 Breeders' Cup Sprint. It was actually won by a fast-closing Elmhurst, but Bet on Sunshine, the Kentucky gelding, ran a big, big race to be third. What, less than a length beaten, right?
Yeah, and I'll tell you, he had the one-hole that day at Hollywood Park, and Ron and Amy, Samantha, everybody said, "Paul, you are in deep doo-doo this race. The one hole at Hollywood Park sprinting is the death hole." So the fact that he ran as big as he did.
Why did they tell you that? Why don't they just leave it alone?
Well, they did. They said, that is not good. But Pat Day rode him for me that day and rode a great race, and he did everything to win. But
that's right.
The fact that he was third, beating 3/4 of a length from the one hole, I thought that was pretty good.
Pretty good indeed. Okay, guys, we're going to watch the 1997 Breeders' Cup Sprint. That's Elmhurst winning, but more importantly, Bet on Sunshine running a huge third.
No, Rob, no.
And they're off. Exotic Wood bobbled coming out of the starting gate. There goes Men's Exclusive, and Track Gal gunned toward the lead as the field moves up the back stretch, and it is Track Gal to the front. He's a bull. In between horses, Men's Exclusive right there on the outside, now running in third. Exotic Wood on the far outside, fourth. Pottery Ponce is fifth. On the inside, English Filly, Carmine Lake racing in sixth. And then it's Northern Afflita, close to the pace, seventh. Richter Scale in mid-pack, he's eighth. On the far outside, Crafty Friend, four wide, ninth. And then it's Bet on Sunshine, tenth, and down toward the inside. Confida's 11th by three. Then Trafalgar, followed by Royal Applause. Elmhurst is the trailer, 21-2. A spectacular first quarter here. They're coming to the top of the stretch, and Track L has lost the lead. It's Exotic Wood on the outside, and he's a bull. The half in 43 4/5 seconds. Confide is coming up the inside. Men's Exclusive and Bet on Sunshine is at the rail. Into the last furlong. It's he's a bull with the short lead. Exotic Wood giving a run on the outside. Bet on Sunshine, and here comes Elmhurst storming down the outside. Elmhurst flying, and here's the line. Elmhurst gets there in the final strides. Much as Lee DeJustice did last year in those same colors. And again, a smiling Janine Sahadi with the result of the sprint. Elmhurst comes off the pace to do it here, beating a Breeders' Cup record in 108 flat.
Blast from the past, 19 years ago, Breeders' Cup sprint. Elmhurst winning. He's a bull was dogged in the middle, but Bet on Sunshine was just coming up the rail. Something fierce. Any point during that race where you thought he's going to win it?
Well, turning for home, it had a pretty good look. And even at the eighth pole, you know with Pat Day, you're always going to have a little something extra. And sure enough, he had a little spurt there at the end that gave us a pretty good thrill.
Do you remember what Pat Day said to you when he got off?
I can't say that.
He goes, "Whoo, that was fun."
But one more jump and no Elmhurst. You know, you were past the horse that ran second, just past the finish line. But Elmhurst just swooped, you know. It's horse racing.
Yeah, it's tough.
Doesn't get much more exciting than that.
Well, right? You know, I was telling you that Exotic Wood, who was fourth in the same race, that's the first time. She was trained by Ron Ellis, our brother-in-law. That's the first time that they ever ran against each other. So I'm sure we had some exactas hooked up pretty big in there. And they were both right there turning for home. So, yeah, I remember John Kimmel was in the same box with me, and he looked at me like I was crazy because I started going, you know, losing my mind a little bit.
There's no feeling like that, and you get to experience that feeling almost every day as a trainer. I've owned horses, and you got one in training right now, Brian. It's just a tremendous feeling, especially the Breeders' Cup or graded stakes like that. It doesn't get much better. So Bet on Sunshine, 3 years later, runs third again to the legendary Corner Goldie, gets beat a length. Continues on after that, Paul, and he retired at 10. When did you know it was time that he's been good to us? Was there an injury involved, or was it just time to say, hey, it's time to retire?
Well, he always scalped a lot in his races, hitting his front ankles with his back feet, and it started to worsen a little bit. And so when he got beat in I forget if it was an allowance race or a stakes race in Arlington as a 10-year-old, and me and Mr. Holloway just agreed it was time. He had been good to us, and minor injuries, but the fact that he was 10 and got beat the way that he did, I'm sure he was favored that day, and we just agreed it was time to pull the plug, basically. Yeah. And giving, he went to Hermitage Farm for a good pension rest of his life. So
very cool. So Marty, during this time, I mean, Paul's training some good horses. You move from Baltimore Sun to the Racing Form. Through the years, like the first few years of the form, I remember when I met Marty, we kind of alluded to this earlier, I think it was the second time I ever spoke to him, I said, Marty, do you play softball? Because we had a killer backstretch league at Arlington back in the day. I'm like, do you play softball? I'm just hoping that, he's a live body out there. And what did you say to me?
I said, bat me third and put me at short.
Yeah.
Because back when we were playing in Maryland, we had a pretty good team back there too. That was when we were young and
cocky.
Yeah, cocky can do a little bit.
It worked out though.
Yeah,
I
remember playing the jocks when you were up there at Arlington. Shane Sellers kept hitting me the ball. And I'm like, come on, keep it. Shane Dibb and Kurt Bork and
Mike.
Isaiah Enriquez, he was probably the best player on our team, but that was always a lot of fun. I just don't, maybe it still exists, and maybe we only think of it because we were younger then.
Yeah.
But I don't know that there is a sense of racetrack community we used to have back there in Chicago and then in Maryland. So.
A lot of it has to do with, the news media has shrank.
The media and just and people had to come to the races as opposed to now they not just go to a simul torture place, but they can just do it at home, as you guys well know, right here in Derby Wars.
Right. So what are some memories from when you first started at the Forum as far as races you covered, stories you wrote? I mean, you're an Eclipse Award winner. That happened a few years ago when you wrote about Kent DeSarmo. But what about the early years of the Forum?
The best story I remember when I wrote for the Sun was going... They sent me on a plane to Pittsburgh, and I went to visit Dale Baird at Mountaineer Park, and that was such an eye-opener. That was in 1991.
How many races did he win? A lot.
He won 9,445 before he was killed on Christmas Eve about 2007. But I remember one of my lines in there was that he's in the same business as Dwayne Lucas, but he's not. It's really kind of a completely different thing. But, this was when Mountaineer was, they might have even called it Waterford Park back then. But I just remember the screen doors were torn and no horses got out of their stalls to train in the morning, and the saddle cloths were faded and torn. And it was just really a compelling story I did. And then, you asked me to think of some of the stories I've written. When Richard Conhorst, I wrote this story about 5 years ago, when he, just out of the blue, Richard Conhorst, who had a fairly small stable, just jumped up and won the Indiana Downs training title one summer. And then his wife died like the 2 days after they were in the winner's circle accepting the trophy for it. It was just really an incredible story. Greta Kunstweiler and her battles with addiction. That's a story I really liked writing. I remember getting a letter, a handwritten letter after that from one of her neighbors who had said she had just been hell on wheels and terrorized the neighborhood. How dare you glorify her? And I'm like, I'm thinking, everybody gets a second chance.
Yeah.
So, and she has gone up time. I'm a big proponent of time proving things. And she has to this day, she's working for Ron Moquette, and yeah, she's doing good. She's been, it's been about 7 years since she came back from that. So, and then, of course, finally, the DeSormo story that I, Paul actually went with me to go see Kent's parents in Maurice, Louisiana, when we were with Keith, and then I went down to Florida, where I've gone quite a bit, and interviewed Kent when he was doing no good at all. And, you know, obviously I'm very happy to see them have, you know, to see them have done as well as they have with Exaggerator. So I was very proud of, I put in a whole lot of work on that DeSormo story, and actually that was the same year that Tim Layden did his tremendous piece on Jeff Lucas. And we were out at Santa Anita for the Breeders' Cup, and I remember saying, ah, man, I think I just got beat for the Eclipse Award. But, you know, because I thought that Tim's piece was 3-5, and I was 5-1, but as we all know, once in a while, 5-1 does beat a 3-5, so that's how that turned out.
People have no idea, and Brian can speak to this, because, I mean, I've written feature stories, and there's different kinds of stories. You have to write recaps, you have to write advances, you have to write short features, but that's a tremendous undertaking to not only interview the subject, but interview all the people around them and try to really capture their essence, good and bad in this case, obviously. And, you know, it's turned out to be a triumphant story, so to speak, with the brothers winning, you know, the Preakness and their favorite in the Belmont. And the story hasn't completely been written yet because Ken's still writing. We'll see where it goes.
Yeah, Keith, I think Keith really showed himself to be the articulate, intelligent guy that he is, that nobody really knew about until he got this good horse with Texas Red, and then, of course, even more so with Exaggerator. So I'm really happy for him.
Did you feel like, kind of writing this article, Marty, that in a way Keith was almost trying to shake Kent by the britches and say, listen, you gotta make some changes in your life? And we still see that kind of playing out now as they're winning these big races with Exaggerator?
Well, you know, the story was about Kent's drinking, as we sit here and drink a beer on the set. And Kent's point, and he had a point, and I think that's what people really identified with, is, you know, just because you drink a beer doesn't make you an alcoholic. Right. And that's kind of the back and forth that's gone on with him and his brother, and there's obviously a lot of elements to it. But I don't know if Keith necessarily used it as a vehicle, because I was the one who came to him initially, and of course I'd known them for so long since our days in Maryland, that I felt like they would both trust me to go ahead and do right by the story and put it in the proper context. So, you know, I'm sure that they still have their own little things going on. I have not, you know, been nosy and asked about how they're doing personally and all that, but you know, they're doing pretty good if they're riding the way that you or anybody we would all like to ride with the success they've had in the Triple Crown.
So Paul, you've had 19 graded stakes wins. We talked about Bet on Sunshine, Suave, I Believe in You, grade one winner, Honor and War, big upset in the Woodford Reserve Turf Classic. When you get a really good horse like this, and you're always looking for the next one, right? How do you go about managing the horse and trying to figure out what do they do best? Because I think one of the most remarkable things about Majestic Harbor is he's an on-the-lead horse going a mile and a half, but he just won the Ali Sheba going a mile and a 16th. Now you've got the Foster going a mile and an 8th. You've got to figure this out, and you've got to learn how to maximize every start. Where do they go? How do you go about planning and figuring that out?
Well, I think obviously most of it is the horse's talent, which is hard to train. But in the case of Bet on Sunshine late in his career, Majestic Harbor now is an 8-year-old. So much of it is just trying to have a happy horse. And by that, you use some of their telltale signs of when do they need more training, when do they need less training. But in a word, or the short answer would be, keep them happy.
Yeah.
The placings of, well, and that's another beautiful thing about when you are lucky enough to have a stakes horse, you know your stakes races are going to go. You don't have the battle of entering in races that don't fill and all that. So you can, in fact, map out something of a strategy, you know, a several race strategy and that kind of thing. And so that makes it nice, too. But most of it gets back to having a nice, talented horse. Soundness is always what we have to deal with. You know, if you have a nagging foot bruise or a nagging fetlock injury and things like that, you just deal with them as best you can. But again, in a word, it's just keeping a horse healthy and happy.
Tell us more about his background from the time he was young to what he is now. And, you know, he's been back, he's been to several different racetracks. He's been out of your care for a little bit and come back. And now he's a grade two winner with the Foster coming up, and he's legitimate.
Well, he won a grade one in California for Sean McCarthy. He's had two different stints with Sean. We bought the horse as a yearling. He debuted for me at Churchill, actually Shackelford beating in his debut. He was third behind Shackelford in his debut. He broke his maiden at Fairgrounds. Off of that, we ran him in the Louisiana Derby as a three-year-old. That's the year Pants on Fire won the Louisiana Derby. Fast forward, Sean McCarthy, he was sent out to Sean. Sean's a good friend of Ron Beagle, who's one of the owners of Majestic Harbor. And Sean had him for a few races, sent him back to me. I had him for a while, he won some races. Back to Sean, and on that second trip out to Sean is when he won the Gold Cup, the Grade 1 Gold Cup.
Most races of 2014. Just blew by the field. That Gold Cup by 6.5 lengths.
Very impressive race.
You're watching him win that Gold Cup. Nothing but good feelings, or I wish she was.
Oh no, nothing but good feelings. Yeah, I'm very good friends with all of the owners, the Osbournes, Lauren and David Osborne, and Ron Beagle. They're great clients and good friends of mine.
Did you know you were going to get them back at that point?
Probably, but actually, it was more of a case after the Gold Cup. His form did in fact tail off, and there was actually talk about retiring him and this and that. But they said, well, let's send him back to Kentucky. See how he does, and lucky for me, he's done very well since coming back.
Done very well, including an Ali Sheba win last time. So we are talking about the Grade 1 Foster, June 18th, Churchill Downs. We're going to see him, Eagle, who will be beating Ali Sheba.
I think FNX will be the likely favorite, but my horse is doing really well. He actually breezed this morning. He went an easy half mile this morning. And Breeze, just like Majestic Harbor, meaning he went an easy half mile, but then the gallop out was so very strong. It amounted to more like a 5/8 out three-quarter type of breeze, but he was happy coming off the track, and I feel like he's doing really well.
A horse like Penn and Sunshine that you've had for years, and they're old pros, they're 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years old. Are you giving these riders much instruction? Majestic Harbor's won races on the front. He's come from behind. The Akashiba, he was kind of in the middle of the pack and made a big move on the turn. What are you telling the riders on horses that have been doing this for so long?
Consider, Corey Lannery knows Majestic Harbor very well. So to answer your question, I gave no instructions.
No instructions.
I just feel like, which I'm of the opinion and always have been, when I'm legging Corey Lannery up on a horse, when I'm legging Pat Day up in the Breeders' Cup, you know, what's Paul McGee going to tell Pat Day in a Breeders' Cup race?
Listen, Pat.
You know, listen, Pat. I'm not going to do that.
Lay their fifth for a while and then move up to fourth. No, it doesn't work out like that.
I do. I feel very strongly when you're riding Corey Lannery and you're riding Pat Day and you're riding Robbie Alvarado and you're riding Sean Bridge Mohan, and when you're riding. They are professional jockeys. I train them and they ride them. And I do think that they'll ride a better race for you if you cut them some slack, because so much can happen, as you know, when the gate opens. And if they have to call an audible, I want to give them that leeway. So now it irks some of my owners sometimes that I don't give jockeys instructions, but I feel strongly about not giving instructions to your leading riders.
But what about horses that are not as well experienced or as well known?
That's different. I mean, if they have quirks, or a young horse in particular, Swab, for instance, if ever he got in trouble, if he was covered up early in a race, he would call it a day. He'd just go out the back and forget about it. Swab, you absolutely had to keep him out of trouble. if he had an inside post, I would tell the rider, get him clear, find a way to get him under the clear, because he did not like the dog fights against the rail with and taking dirt to the face. He would chuck it and call it a day. If he was in the clear, he would always run a big race.
I've noticed when Paul, even when he's not giving them instructions, like a guy like Lannery will come to the paddocks and say, that doesn't look like there's a lot of speed in here. Should I maybe just follow it? Yeah. And that's the end of the conversation. You know, that's it. You know, it's just like, just kind of an acknowledgement that Corey has done his homework. You know, they read the form and like that.
There you go. And with a horse like that you know inside and out, 41 races he's had, vast majority have been with you. Do you know when he's going to run a big race, like when he's sitting on one of his top efforts, meaning, you know, what are some of the signs you see? You mentioned the workout today, how well he's hitting the feed tub. I mean, for the viewers out there, you go in every race that you enter him in with confidence, but I'm guessing sometimes you're even more confident than others.
Well, I think, in fact, one of the biggest factors is the feed tub. You would be amazed how often horses will go off their feed after a race, for instance, or after a strenuous workout. They'll lay down more often, and they'll back out of the feed tub. And you might think the opposite. You know, if they go out there for a hard race, that they're going to eat like a hog that night. But it works the other way around with horses. And so there's having them knocked out, and then basically just try to get them doing well again. But this kind of gets back to, we were talking earlier, as a trainer, I think being a good handicapper comes into play too. I think that a horse may be doing great, eating good, feeling good, doing really well, but how often does the bounce come into play and it tricks us trainers? We say, well, daggone, that horse was eating everything and doing great. Well, if you look at him on paper, you say, oh, well, he ran back on 2 weeks rest off of a huge race last time. Well, that horse bounced. And so to get feedback from horse players, good handicappers, you know, I'll bounce stuff off of Marty sometimes in relation to that kind of thing. So a horse might be doing great, but you have to use the common sense of placing them in the right, the timing needs to be right. That's not to say you can't run a horse back on 7 days rest, because you can, and I've done it successfully.
Sure.
And there is such a thing as wheeling a horse back quick, but it's getting to know your horse and giving them those breaks when they need them, and just trying to time everything. It's about timing.
Handicapping, I think, is a big part of what you do that I think people don't realize how important that is for not only a jockey, but trainer especially.
Yeah, Marty knows this. You have to handicap the trainer too, right?
You have to. That's pretty much the first thing I look at when I'm doing my. If you're doing a 90-second drill, the simul torture part, you know, and you're like, wanting to know who to bet on, I just kind of go through the trainers, you know, because I have this theory about jockeys. There's 400 jockeys in North America who, if you put them on the best horse in the Kentucky Derby, they will win. Mm-hmm. I mean, as Shane Sellers once told me, and I'll never forget it, he says, I can only ride them as fast as they can run.
Yeah.
Now, the trainer, to me, he's the guy putting in most of the work, so I do go by the trainer. So it's, yeah.
All right, well, good timing for Majestic Harbor and the Alley Sheba.
Let's do it. Majestic Harbor, of course, is Paul McGee's latest graded stakes winner. It was Oaks Day, the day before the Derby. Majestic Harbor was not one of the favorites, but in the Alley Sheba, beating horses like Eagle and Noble Bird, and we're going to see him, of course, in the upcoming Grade 1 Stephen Foster. It was all Majestic Harbor, and he beat another Majestic Warrior, was
Majestic
it?
Affair.
Majestic Affair. That one.
Yeah. Eagle was second there. It was the Paul McGee and Neil Howard exact.
That's a nice exact. The Eagle rallied for second, but Paul's horse ran a huge race and won by two and a half lengths. Let's watch that 2016 Alley Sheba Stakes from Kentucky Oaks Day.
There in the gate. And they're off. Slow start for Noble Bird. Majestic Affair breaks on top. Far outside, Majestic Harbor's away well. Cat Burglars asks for speed for the inside post and punches up on through.
And so Cat Burglar takes the field into the clubhouse turn. Majestic Affair second on the outside. Natchez is right up against the fence running along in third. Majestic Harbor's in the clear while fourth. Noble Bird is hard to control early on, is restive on the far outside, fighting the rider just a bit. Meanwhile, Departing is saving ground and is sneaking up into fifth now. And right between horses is Eagle running along in sixth. Noble Bird is hard held at the back in seventh. And it's two lengths back to Top Billing at the back of the pack. 24-1 the first quarter, heading down the back stretch run. And Cat Burglar is loose on the lead, clear by a length and a half with five furlongs to go. Majestic Affair in pursuit of the outside second. Natchez on hold third toward the rail. Departing is right in the thick of things, racing in fourth and only three lengths off the lead. Majestic Harbor started to make some progress on the far outside. Eagles at the back of that first flight, and it's a tight pack onto the far turn. At the back are Noble Bird and Top Billing, very tightly packed with three furlongs to go. And Cat Burglar still to catch. Majestic Affair under more pressure now. And on the outside, Majestic Harbor is winding up third, second, and now first. Here's Majestic Harbor on the outside, putting in a bid for the lead. Departing is right in behind. Top Billing Eagle under pressure. Not today for Noble Bird. Top of the stretch, Majestic Harbor on the outside, and Majestic Affair, these two locked in battle with 3/16 to go. On the outside, Majestic Harbor. On the inside, Majestic Affair. Capper, we're back into third. Eagle with a steady close. Eagle's got a shot on the outside. Three lengths to make up. It's Majestic Harbor in front by two. Majestic Affair, could it keep up? Eagle lay close. Here's the wire. Majestic Harbor the winner. By 2.5, it's tight for second. Eagle or Majestic Affair. Cat Burglar was fourth.
Majestic Harbor is such an interesting horse. On his best day, Majestic Harbor can beat just about anybody. He doesn't always have his best day. But do you know when, this performance is... Big Majestic Harbor, one of his best races of his life, now 8 years old. Did you have a good feeling going in?
Yeah, I really did. He was kind of touting himself going into that race. The way he was dancing and prancing, going to and from the track.
I'm going to give you my cell phone number so you can text me these situations. Yeah. You don't want it. Says his brother.
Yeah, well, I think he got 102 buyer in winning the Abishiba, which was one of his. I think he may have gotten 103 or 4 in winning the Gold Cup, but one of his best races for sure. And to be peaking right now, it's great. And I think the 6 weeks between the Abishiba and the Stephen Foster is perfect. I think the timing's good. He loves this track. He's always run very well at Churchill on the dirt. He's got one clunker on the grass at Churchill, but his dirt record at Churchill is great. And Corey knows him, and we're really looking forward to it.
Do we dare talk about the race after the Foster? I mean, we're talking Saratoga. If the Foster is as big as the Alice Jingle was.
We're not going to talk about it.
We're not going to talk about it. All right. So, I tried.
Mile and Eighth is obviously he's won a mile and a half. How many times has he run against neck and neck? A lot, right?
Yeah.
That's Ian Wilkes's, right? They've been in some of these mile and a half battles together. Mm-hmm. But he's one going a mile and a half. He's one going a mile and a 16th. The Foster's a mile and an eighth. Do you think against similar competition, mile and an eighth is his best?
I would say that. I like the Abishiba mile and a 16th. There's absolutely nothing wrong with stretching him out to the mile and an eighth in the Foster. I think, if anything, it's a positive, a very positive.
But as a handicapper, do you agree with that?
Yeah, I would. I mean, 2 weeks later, after the Abishiba, they ran the Pimlico Special at Pimlico, and Noble Bird just airballed after having just a brutal, if you really watch that race, the Abishiba close, he really had a tough trip in there. And I was thinking after both Stanford and Paige McKinney scratched, was Paul, I haven't asked him this yet, were you thinking, man, we should be in that race, because we just handed Noble Bird his head, and, you would have been one of the favorites in there. I Noble Bird ran his eyeballs out in winning the race. I don't know if he would have beat him that day.
Well, we never considered the Pimlico race, right. just because of the timing.
But it's the kind of thing where the race is, what, 350 or whatever the Pimlico Special was, and you're like, oh, man, look at the way that fell apart. It's kind of a different thing to happen. But anyway.
But you can't dance every day.
Yeah, you can't. But Noble Burke did. He ran in the alley sheet and then he ran right back to the pit over to special. But anyway.
He didn't do much dancing in the alley sheet.
That's right. There you go. Right. Yeah. Yeah, you were set up for a classic bounce. I think Noble Burke would have won. He would have beat you that day. But see, that's the kind of realistic thing that I can tell. It doesn't hurt his feelings if I tell him that.
Yeah. But then with the trainer, the horse is telling you 6-7 weeks. And correct. It's the foster, yeah. So.
Right, exactly. Right after the alley sheet, you're sitting back saying, man, all you got to do is lead him over. Keep him happy for 6 weeks. And right now, we don't know who's going to run in the Stephen Foster, but you've got Eagle, who will probably appreciate 9 furlongs, too.
Eagle's a good horse.
We talked to Neil Howard about him. We've got FNX, who we know is solid, 1.8 miles, 1.25 miles.
Yeah, he looks like he's 4 or 5 in there now. Right. That's all we know now. The racing office told me no Todd Pletcher horses are coming for the Foster. I mean, the way it is right now, you never know, but it looks like a short field.
You might get one of these recent allowance horses, like that Hawkdom or whatever that won the other day.
Yeah.
But obviously you want to try to fill out the field. But you're going to be in the sweet spot. I mean, probably as the co-second choice with Eagle, I would think. That's a great spot to be in on your home track.
Yeah. Right? FNX has one race here. It was pretty good last fall.
Yeah. It was real good.
Yeah.
Clark, that was probably his best race.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Breeders' Cup Classic runner-up, of course, last year. Marty, let's get back to your career a little bit, your illustrious career now, an Eclipse Award winning career. You said something interesting about your favorite articles, and the one thing I noticed, and maybe these are the articles that are the most in-depth, the most time-consuming, but they were about the people, as opposed to, more often than not, you're writing about horses. Big difference between writing about people versus horses? I know there is for me.
You know what? That's very true. I learned when I went to the University of Kentucky that when I went out to Keeneland, the people were a lot nicer than the jocks. And believe me, I know about playing sports, so I played them all the time. Paul can attest, I played baseball, softball, and football, and basketball. And the jocks were kind of very condescending. I was their peers, but they were way advanced physically and everything. So when you went around the football players or basketball players, well, they were the superstars and you were down there. And it kind of clinched the deal for me in that I'd already had this big love for horse racing anyway. As a matter of fact, our dad wouldn't let me go to I was the oldest of the four. He wouldn't let me go to the Derby until I was in high school, which meant I missed Secretariat in 73, and I'm still mad at him about that. Not really. But then Amy, our baby sister, she got to go to the Derby when she was in 6th grade. I'm like, I thought the rule was you had to be in high school. But anyway, just the people in the game are what really got me. And it was kind of, that point was punctuated when I went to UK and just, you know, Keeneland's so easy to like anyway. You go out there and it's just a place you fall in love with. And I've been fortunate enough to cover it now for 22 years for the Forum. But back when I was in college, I used to schedule my classes in the mornings, you know, that way in April and October I could be out of the track. And, I ended up writing stories. Ronnie Franklin was one of my first interviews ever, and that was in 79. And he told me all the records, something that I can't say right now, because it's still on the record 37 years later. They're like, dude, because we were the same age, we were like 19. I'm like, you shouldn't be telling me this. But anyway, you know, stuff like that. I've gotten to meet a whole lot of great people. I remember many years later, when we were living in Maryland, Bud Delp and I had dinner together in Ellicott City, you know, and he got to recount, you know, he just loved talking about it. Spectacular bit.
Ron Franklin's ride in the 1979 Florida Derby, perhaps?
Yeah, he would tell you about that. You know, just if you go back and watch it on YouTube, the 79 Florida Derby, it was like a 5-horse field. Like Ronnie Franklin couldn't have messed up more times, you know, on that race. So,
and the bit's still one going away.
Yeah. So, you know, and it just the people in the game, the people who I've had the fortune to work with in the press boxes in Maryland, Chicago, and Kentucky, and elsewhere. Like when I'd go to Canterbury every year, those guys were great. There was a guy named Dark Star, and I'd say his first name was Dark. you know, his real name was, I don't know, but he just died a few years ago, but he was a great guy, and just all the people you get to meet in this game are really what makes it so much, you know, so fulfilling.
It comes full circle what we talked about earlier, all of us just loving our jobs and loving what we do, and the backstretch is being a special place and being able to report on it, and it's the least monotonous thing. It's monotonous in what we do, but the least monotonous because every race is different, every course is different, every story rate is different. And that brings me to what I want to kind of get to now, Marty, which is 2016 in the racing form. Things have changed a lot since you first started there. You know, print is not nearly what it used to be. A lot of it's vast majority online now, behind a paywall to a certain extent, people printing PPs, a lot of video content. And the latest thing is the DRF Live, which I love because people want information now. Back in the newspaper days, you would be reading stuff in the morning that was already 16 hours old. Now you're giving us changes, you're telling us what happened on the backstretch. That morning, we're reading about it on DRF Live through Twitter instantaneously. It's a different world, but it's a more up-to-speed world. And I think DRF Live has been a great revelation for the forum.
Yeah, it's been a terrific initiative by the people. Of course, we're in Manhattan, and we had a huge come-to-Jesus kind of meeting a couple years ago, right after the Belmont, 2014. And like you said, if you're not tech savvy in terms of DRF Live and Twitter especially, I mean, a lot of us guys at DRF have a lot of Twitter followers. It's really an extremely important medium for us, and it essentially has replaced the print form. Although a lot of people, including myself, like to have that thing in my hand. It's very handy. And so we still sell, I think our revenues are about 50-50 in terms of all our online sales and then our print sales too. So, I mean, I can't imagine going to the Derby, the Oaks, the Breeders' Cup, not having a racing form in your hand. So, you know, there's that element to it. So, yeah, but we have been, our bosses at DRF have been extremely conscious of the changing world and how we need to do it. I appreciate you talking about DRF Live like that, but Twitter and DRF Live are very uppermost in terms of our duties.
And Paul, how has your job changed over the years? I mean, training a horse is training a horse. But back when you first started training, I don't think there were rags and sheets. The game has changed so much where you have to be conscious of your statistics because every Paul McGee statistic is out there for the public to see. Has it changed the way you do your job?
Well, everybody knows I can't win on the first time starter.
That's true. That's not true. Bald Warrior paid $66 a few years ago.
You and Ian Wilkes.
I would say
that. What about a two-horse race between those two the first time starters?
Well, they're barn mates, you know. They're right next to each other every year, so.
You know, a big thing for me as a trainer, you know, it used to be phone calls from the landline in the kitchen and that kind of thing when I first started training. But now, you know, the stable males, Equibase and DRF and the Kenny McPeaks app, you know, it's great because anytime I have a horse that breezes, the owner gets notified pretty much right away, which I think it's great.
There you go. Yeah.
I know Samantha Siegel. I seldom talk to her on the phone because she may text me, oh, I see that horse had a good work this morning, and that kind of thing. So the technology is great as far as I'm concerned, as far as owners being able to have stable mail and having their horses in their virtual stable.
Churchill's
out, right?
They're doing a racing club there. They've got a couple horses with D-Wayne Lucas, which is a new thing, right?
Very interesting.
Yeah, and it's been extremely popular. And this is a question, you know, for Marty and yourself, and Brian and I have talked about this, you know, ad nauseum. But what can the game do to, that's a good thing. The DRF Live is a good thing. Technology, Facebook, Twitter. What can we do to appeal to the younger generation, interest potential horse owners, and make this game even healthier into the future? What do you guys think?
I don't know that much about the upstart racing club that D-Wayne is I don't know how popular that's been. I don't know if they're off to a good start or not. Do you know, Marty?
Yeah, they've had 200 people put in $500 a piece equals $100,000. It's just a way to get people involved, not necessarily hands-on, but they are permitted to come around and they get free stuff to come into the track and everything. I think it's a terrific thing. As a matter of fact, it was so popular that it's gone more than 200. I think they're on a second
they're
horse.
They're on a second horse now,
so it's been up
to Arlington 2 is on two horses.
Yeah, there you go. So process. It's just people want to be involved in this game because they, you know, they're like us. They think it's the greatest thing ever invented.
But it can be a little intimidating.
So it can be, you know? And it's the way to ease them into it and be nice to them. You know, people want to, it's like I was talking about the football players and the basketball players, they really weren't that nice. You know, and people in racing are nice, you know, and Wayne, a guy like Wayne Lucas, you know, he has everybody's attention. So, I mean, I've always said this about various things that have been floated up, and some of them have gone and some of them have failed. Why not? I mean, why not try this? What? Who's getting hurt by it? So, heck yeah.
Right on. Brian, anything else before we wrap up with these guys?
I want to embarrass Marty just for a minute. I don't know if you're even going to remember this or if you want to hear it again. I think you were a little mad when it was brought up. The first time I met Marty was only about 6 or 7 years ago at Arlington Park. We were introduced, I think we were in the racing office, and the first thing I said to Marty was, you were one of the guys. So I was a college student. Marty's not that much older than me. So he was a young writer at the time. I was a college student, and I was sending my, wanting to be a turf writer down the road, I was sending my Breeders' Cup analysis, this full-blown, whatever it was back then, seven-race Breeders' Cup analysis. Every horse had a comment. It was 2 weeks before the race. I picked Mia Farah to do really well in the Breeders' Cup sprint, long hats from Chicago. And I sent this out to a dozen people that I respected in the business at the time. Marty McGee was one of them. And I think out of the dozen people, I got two responses back. Both were very positive, both saying, you know, this is good stuff, you should pursue it. One of them was Edward Bowen, who was the main guy, the editor of Blood Horse at the time. And the other guy was a young reporter, Marty McGee, and I always appreciated that. And I think when I told him, he got a little mad, because how old are you? You're like 2 years older than me, and you're talking about when you were a kid sending this in. But anyway, I always appreciated that you took the time to write me a letter.
All right, I don't remember that again, but I think it's great, so thank you.
But that's
you.
Important. Yeah, I mean, we've all been mentors to people.
Yeah, you know, pay it forward.
Pay it forward for sure. Like, Dave Sirico answered my, you know, first letter, called me on the phone, went up to this press box at Sportsman's Park, and you get to meet people, and you get your foot in the door. People always ask me, how do you get involved in this business? Well, today's generation, for some reason, kind of has a little bit of an entitlement where they think they're just going to jump into a prominent job where you've got to pay your dues, you've got to cut your teeth, you've got to impress people, you've got to move your way up, and you can get there. It's easier to get that now because everybody has a blog, right?
Right.
Back in our day, I didn't have a forum. You know, I had to get an opportunity in the press box at Hawthorne, you know, faxing overnights.
But ultimately, it all comes out in the wash. Who's doing their homework? Who's doing the reading? Who's right. doing the research? Who's
impress
doing,
people.
Who's doing what he did when he was 15?
Right.
You know? Who's learning the ropes?
Yeah, very true. Brian, any final thoughts?
I think this was fun. The McGee brothers, thank you for coming in, Marty. Right.
Thanks.
By the way, he's still, after 6 years, 6-7 years in the press box, he still never calls me Brian. What do you call me every time you see me, Marty?
Z-A-T-T, Zipsy at the track.
What do you call me?
Zat. Skull.
Just Skull.
Yeah,
one of four people that still call me that. Dave Sirico, Vic Stoffer, Marty McGee, and Pat Mitchell, wherever he is.
I don't even know what that means. What does it mean? Tell
it's
me.
What, it's what his teenage, when he was a teenager, some had a little rat skull that he found or something.
Part of the story, but the reason the name came up is because I got to fill in for Dave Sirico doing his box picks. And my last name's Christofek, so it's like not exactly a memorable last name. So I told all my buddies, all my drinking buddies, I'm going to put my name in the newspaper as Joe Skull.
And did it?
Yes. It showed up in the box picks. Though. There used to be the box picks where it would be Dave Sirico,
yeah.
John Brock, Neil Milbert. And
John Brock, as he did.
I haven't heard from him in the last few years, but he's doing fine.
Good.
But yeah, so that's how it kind of stuck. Dave called me on the phone and lectured me for 15 minutes while he was laughing under his breath because he thought it was funny too. So, lots of great racing stories, and yeah. It's always great to be able to share them with you guys, and we appreciate your time. And
thank you.
Look forward to more good stuff down the road. Good luck with Majestic Harbor.
Thank you.
And we'll see if Marty picks him in the Stephen Foster.
Stephen Foster, June 18th, Churchill Downs, Grade 1, Majestic Harbor, one of the big horses. Thank you, Marty McGee. Thank you, Paul McGee, for joining us tonight. We'll be back next Wednesday, always Wednesday night, here with another Triple Crown Belmont Stakes Insider. We didn't talk about the Belmont show. Maybe we should just quick exaggerator. Is he going to win? Is he going to get? Is he a vulnerable favorite?
I'm for the Brothers de Sarmo.
I like exaggerator also. Exaggerator and a creator. Colder exactly.
Steve Asmussen.
You know who I'm picking.
Who are you picking?
Start right back to my
I think it'll be even money or so on exaggerator and a whole bunch of them between 7 and 11 to 1.
That's going to be fun. I mean, there's no Triple Crown on the line, but all of these races tell their own story, right? It's going to be interesting to see how the Belmont plays out.
Stradivari maybe on the lead. I like him too, Joe. Brody's Cause maybe is a longer one. Exaggerator. It's hard to look past Exaggerator's last three races. Anyway, we'll be back next week, folks. Next Wednesday night for another Belmont Stakes Insider. We'll see you then. Joe, what do you got going on after this?
Well, I'll be, another weekend at Churchill, Thursday night twilight. We've got the big single six carryover. And then in the immediacy, we've got the Derby Wars webcast coming up next. So learn how to play some tournaments, everybody.
Have a good night.